Hello and welcome. This is Math 135, Introduction to Statistics, and this is your instructor, Asma Laib. Today, we're going to talk about Chapter 2. Specifically, we will talk about Section 2.1, Organizing Qualitative Data. In this section, we will learn how to organize qualitative data in tables, construct bar graphs, construct pie charts. In this section, we will concentrate on tabular and graphical summaries of qualitative data. Recall that qualitative, or we call the categorical data, provide measures that categorize or classify an individual. When data is collected from a survey or designed experiment, they must be organized into a manageable form. Data that is not organized is referred to as raw data. We have several ways to organize our data. Today, we will discuss how to organize it in tables, graphs, and numerical summaries. We will discuss this deeply in Chapter 3. When raw qualitative data are collected, we often first determine the number of individuals within each category. This will lead us to the next definition, which is a frequency distribution. A frequency distribution lists each category of data and the number of occurrences for each category of data. Here is an example to show us how to organize qualitative data into a frequency distribution. The data on the next slide represents the color of M&Ms in a bag of plain M&Ms. We want to construct a frequency distribution of the color of plain M&Ms. So let's look at this example. We have the M&Ms in the plain bag of M&Ms listed in front of us, and we want to organize it into a frequency distribution, meaning creating a table that contains categories, the number of occurrences of each color. So here is the example with the raw data represented in front of us. I noticed that we have the brown color, the yellow color, the red color, the orange, blue, and green. I will make my table look like that. I will have a column that represents the category, which is the color. Another column will represent the tallies. And then the frequency is the number of occurrences of each color, which is, I'm going to count my tallies right here. So after you create your table, you go back to your raw data. Now we're going to count the brown colors. So let's count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So we have 12 brown M&Ms. We go back to our table and we make our tallies. So 12, the frequency is 12. You can skip this part altogether, but if you want to keep it for records, you can. And so on. So you're going to create your table using this method right here. You will end up with something like that. So the brown color appears 12 times, the yellow color appears 10 times, the red color appears 9 times, the orange appears 6 times, the blue appears 3 times, the green appears 5 times. And as you can see, it is not in descending or ascending order yet. In any frequency distribution, it is a good idea to add up the frequency column, just to make sure that it equals the number of observations we have. In the example here, we have 45 observations. We add this up and it adds up to 45, so we're not missing any of our raw data. Often we want to know the relative frequency of the categories rather than the frequencies themselves. What is the relative frequency? A relative frequency is the proportion or percent of observations within a category, and it is found using the formula below. Relative frequency is basically you take the frequency and divide that by the sum of all frequencies. A relative frequency distribution lists each category of data with the relative frequency. And here is an example on how to find the relative frequency. Consider the previous example of M&Ms. This is the frequency table that we came up with from the last example. And to find the relative frequency table, take the frequency and divide that by the sum of all frequencies, like so. Once raw data are organized in a table, we can create graphs. Graphs allow us to see the data and help us understand what the data are saying about the individuals in the study. A common device for graphically representing qualitative data is a bar graph. So what is a bar graph? A bar graph is constructed by labeling each category of data on either the horizontal or vertical axis and the frequency or relative frequency of the category on the other axis. Rectangles of equal width are drawn for each category. The height of each rectangle represents the category's frequency or relative frequency. So basically, now we're going to learn how to construct frequency bar graphs or relative frequency bar graphs. And here is an example to show us how to construct a frequency bar graph and a relative frequency bar graph using the previous example of the M&M's data that was provided for us. So here is the frequency table that we created using the data from the M&M's example. And this is the frequency bar graph that represents the M&M's colors. And I will show you how to do that on Excel in a separate video. Here is the frequency table that we created from the previous example of M&M's. And here is the relative frequency bar graph for M&M color. And I will show you how to create this also using Excel on a separate video. As you can see here, the bar graph shows us that the least common color in our bag was the blue, while the most common color was the brown. So it gives us an idea of which color is very common in our bag and which color is the least common in our bag. So that is some helpful information right there. In bar graphs, the order of categories does not usually matter. However, bar graphs that have categories arranged in decreasing order of frequency help prioritize categories for decision-making purposes in areas such as quality control, human resources, and marketing. This leads us to the next definition, which is a Pareto chart. Pareto chart is a bar graph where the bars are drawn in decreasing order of frequency or relative frequency. Here is a Pareto chart, which represents the categories in decreasing order. So after you organize the data in decreasing manner, you can create this using Excel. I will show you how to do that in a separate video. And another form of bar graphs is the side-by-side bar graphs. This is specifically useful when we want to compare two sets of data. Suppose that we want to know whether more people are finishing college today than in 1990s. We could draw a side-by-side bar graph to compare the data for the two different years. Data sets should be compared by using relative frequencies instead of frequencies because different sample or population sizes make comparison using frequencies difficult or misleading. And here is an example to illustrate the side-by-side bar graph to compare two data sets. The following data represents the marital status in millions of U.S. residents 18 years of age or older in 1990s and 2006. We want to draw a side-by-side relative frequency bar graph of the data. First, we need to create the relative frequency distribution for the year 1990 and then for the year 2006. And hopefully you still remember that the relative frequency is equal to the frequency divided by the sum of all frequencies. So after we create those two tables, we can represent them using side-by-side bar graphs as follows. So this is our side-by-side bar graph. And as you can see, we have a key right here. The light blue represents the marital status in 1990s, and the dark blue represents the marital status in 2006. And from this bar graph, you can notice some trends in our data. The proportion of married people in 1990s seems to be higher than the proportion of people who were married in the year 2006. Compared to the never married category, we notice that the proportion of never married people in 1990s is less than the proportion of people who never married in 2006. Sometimes, instead of drawing our bars vertically, we draw them horizontally. We call that a horizontal bar graph. Bar graphs that have horizontal bars usually are preferred when the category names are lengthy. This example illustrates the horizontal bar graphs. As you can notice, the category names are very lengthy, so it helps to make them horizontal so we have more space to write our categories. Another form of organizing qualitative data is to construct pie charts. A pie chart is a circle divided into sectors. Each sector represents a category of data. The area of each sector is proportional to the frequency of the category. And here is an example of how to construct a pie chart. The following data represents the marital status in millions of U.S. residents 18 years of age or older in the year 2006. We want to draw a pie chart of the data. As you can notice, we have a frequency distribution, and we need to create a relative frequency distribution to be able to make the pie chart. After we do that, we can draw the pie chart using Excel, and I will show you how to do that in a separate video. Thank you, and I'll see you in class.